An aircraft carrier is the flagship of the fleet, a titan at sea, and a symbol of power. Aircraft carriers are huge. They carry an entire airborne army on board and can influence entire regions by the mere fact of their presence. The most powerful and largest of these are the US Navy nuclear aircraft carriers, 333-meter-long monsters with a displacement of 100,000 tons. Any layman seeing the size and power of these titans will admire them, but a person who knows the possibilities of modern shipbuilding may have a daring thought that these ships are not as big as they could be. At first glance, this idea seems absurd. Aircraft carriers are huge, and in the course of their evolution, they were getting bigger and bigger. But if you look closely, you can see a pattern. Aircraft carriers became full-fledged during World War II, when they began to conquer the seas, pushing away battleships. Essex-class ships were up to 270 meters long and weighed about 46,000 tons. The large post-war Forrestal and Kitty Hawk-class aircraft carriers weighed up to 60,000 tons and were 326 meters long. The legendary USS Enterprise, the world's first nuclear-powered aircraft carrier, was 342 meters long and displaced 94,000 tons. Modern Nimitz-class giants have crossed the coveted mark of 100,000 tons, and their length is 332 meters. So while getting a little heavier, they became slightly shorter than the Enterprise. And now, at the beginning of the 21st century, the newest Gerald Ford class appears. 333 meters and 100,000 tons. Which means that with all the innovations, in terms of dimensions and displacement, it is almost identical to the old Nimitz. As we can see, the development of ships does not at all mean the increase in their size. So what? Isn't 100,000 tons enough for you? Such a huge figure is probably the ceiling. Is it? For example, the top modern cruise ships are up to 340 meters long. Close, but their weight at the same time is up to 150,000 tons. That is heavier by a half. And even that is not that much. The largest tanker, Seawise Giant, had a maximum displacement of 560,000 tons and was a whopping 458 meters long, which makes it 125 meters longer and 4.5 times heavier than the Ford aircraft carrier. And this monster was born back in the 1970s, so in theory, aircraft carriers can be much larger. Keeping that in mind, the logic of shipbuilders seems strange. An aircraft carrier is a floating airbase. Imagine a ship half a kilometer long and displacing 200,000 tons. Such a giant carrier would have a real airbase on deck, to which not only carrier-based planes and helicopters, but also larger machines could fly. In addition, such dimensions of the ship would significantly increase its carrying capabilities. A larger hangar with more aircraft, more space for fuel and ammunition, better equipment and weapons, not just a couple of modest air defense systems on the sides. You'd think they should just go ahead and do it, but they don't. Why not? The first problem that shipbuilders would have to face is in fact building it. On the one hand, we already know about the possibilities of modern industry, capable of building ships of absolutely epic size and mass. On the other hand, we are not talking about ordinary ships. An aircraft carrier has many specific design solutions, is equipped with very specific elements, and has very specific power plants, often nuclear. And not every shipyard is capable of installing a reactor. In addition, an aircraft carrier is obviously a warship, and this imposes even more stringent requirements, not only technical, but also political. Each country builds such ships exclusively at home and exclusively at shipyards authorized for this. These shipyards are adapted for the construction of classic military ships, not tankers and cruise ships. So for a giant aircraft carrier, you would first have to build a giant dock and all the adjacent infrastructure. The creation of the Gerald Ford aircraft carrier cost the US budget a fortune, about $12 billion. Its subsequent relatives in this class will be cheaper, but hardly by much. And now the question is, how much would a giant aircraft carrier cost under the conditions we described? $20 billion? and we're not even including the costs of maintenance and support of the life cycle, which, I should note, must stretch for many decades. The military budget, even if it is the US military budget, is not infinite, and the total cost of a fleet of flagship aircraft carriers has limits. Considering that giant carriers would be much more expensive, their number would have to be reduced. The American fleet needs 10 large aircraft carriers, and if the dream of gigantism came true, it would not be possible to build as many. And then it is a question of strategy. Can, let's say, 5 giants perform the tasks of 10 ordinary ships? Unlikely. There would be too few of them to provide the fleet with the necessary flexibility and responsiveness, and 5 ships, in any case, are more vulnerable than 10. Putting all eggs in one basket is dangerous, even if it is a steel basket weighing 200,000 tons. Moreover, in military cycles, an idea has long been circulating that 10 large and expensive forts are not needed, and it would be better to build ships even smaller and cheaper, as long as their numbers were larger. Let's move on to flexibility issues. Let's imagine that the budget was suddenly found, the shipyards were modernized and issued to the fleet as many as 10 giant aircraft carriers. Success? Right upon entering service, the new ships would run into extremely unpleasant problems. The first problem is the infrastructure to service the ships. The fleet has dozens of bases and docks built over decades, and it just so happens that they were not built for 500-meter-long monsters. How much will their large-scale modernization cost? What about outside of bases? Giant tankers, cruise ships, and cargo ships are rather limited and demanding vessels. They make specific trips between ports prepared for them. An aircraft carrier is not a cruise ship. It is created not for cruises, but for work wherever they send it. And where they send it, there may not be any suitable base or ports capable of receiving it. As a result, you may run into a situation where for any simple maintenance or repair, the giant aircraft carrier will have to sail to its base, which may be on the other side of the Earth. From the point of view of the operational readiness of the fleet, this is unacceptable. Not enough nuances, let's add more. Consider the largest modern ships, such as Ford and Nimitz. Each of these aircraft carriers is capable of carrying up to 100 different aircraft, planes, helicopters, and drones. At the moment, the base of their air groups are the FA-18 jets, ship-based versions of the 5th-generation F-35C fighters, as well as various auxiliary vehicles such as AWACS aircraft, electronic warfare, transport aircraft, and so on. All this equipment is created under certain requirements of the Navy, specifically for such ships as Nimitz and Ford. These requirements are strict, but they have already been mastered. Now imagine that the Pentagon ordered the construction of a giant aircraft carrier. What are its requirements for aircraft? Obviously, a larger deck will ease the requirements. There will be more space for takeoffs and landings, and loads will decrease. At first glance, this is good. But replacing ships of one class with another is a very long process. The Ford class is being commissioned, but the Nimitz class will sail for many more years. But they are very close, and the aircraft made for them are the same. The giant aircraft carrier requires other aircraft modifications, and even if making them will be easier, they still need to be made. The F-35 from the Nimitz on the Giant will have unnecessary modifications, while the F-35 from the Giant on the Nimitz will not be able to work at all. And the process of changing classes is long. Under such conditions, it will turn out that the military has to simultaneously maintain several fleets of different aircraft for carriers of different classes, and this is also very difficult and expensive. Now let's look in the opposite direction. Carrier-based aircraft with all modifications are still demanding on their place of service. Fighters have high takeoff and landing speeds. In addition to the thrust of the engine and deck equipment, the ship itself is very helpful for acceleration and deceleration. An aircraft carrier in a combat mode moves at a speed of more than 30 knots, about 56 kilometers per hour, which means that the plane, just standing on the deck, is already moving at a speed of 30 knots relative to the air around it, and it will need less acceleration. The same with the landing. An aircraft approaching the moving deck will have, relative to it, a decently lower speed. Modern cruise ships and tankers operate at speeds of 20 to 25 knots on average, which is not enough for an aircraft carrier. And to accelerate to 30 knots, you'd have to significantly boost the power plant, which, again, is very difficult and expensive. In addition, an aircraft carrier, even with the status of a floating airfield, is still a warship, and it must have both high speed and decent maneuverability. Giant ships can hardly boast of these qualities. From all the factors described, we can conclude that the problems of the giant aircraft carrier are completely solvable. It just requires large financial injections. So what? It's the same with the other giant ships. The answer to this question is a description of the difference between these types of ships. Cargo ships, tankers, cruise ships, and other similar vessels are commercial. They carry cargo, fuel, and passengers, and the bigger they are themselves, the more they can carry, the more profit they can bring. An aircraft carrier is a warship. Yes, like all other armed forces, it contributes to the most important thing for the country, security. However, in itself, it is not an economic asset, and in normal operation, it only incurs expenses. Here it is important to very carefully maintain a balance between the tool that provides security and the price for this tool. A weak and blunt dagger will not protect the knight, just as the most powerful and sharp sword will be useless if its owner dies of starvation after spending all the money on it. The current aircraft carriers are in the center of this balance, and they are exactly what they should be, whether they are in the fleet of the United States, Great Britain, France, China, Russia, or any other country. Everyone has their own balance, and everyone has their own aircraft carriers. On this, we can end the dispute about the sizes. Alas, we will not see a giant aircraft carrier. But on the other hand, these monsters are also not that small. Comment what you think about these mighty machines, and don't forget to like and subscribe to the channel so as not to miss new videos. There's still a lot of interesting things on the horizon.